Thanks. Thank you, Ansel, and I would like also to thank Olympus for giving us this forum, this opportunity to present our experience and discuss some issues with technology and endoscopic surgery, endoscopic sinus and skull-based and orbital surgery. And my name is Christos Georgalas. I work primarily in Athens. I'm affiliated also with Leiden. So the first slide is basically, I made it when I was teaching in Lisbon about a month ago. And I was drawn by the evolution of navigators and discoveries that, well, the Portuguese and particularly navigators from Lisbon are famous for. And if you try to understand how this happened, why some people started to navigate and to explore and to discover new lands, there were three, I think, I try to understand it. I think there are three main factors. One is that there is a need for a new product, in that case, a new way to reach India and to trade. The second thing is that there were technical advances that would make this possible, and this was the creation of better ships, better systems of navigation. And the third issue was a change in culture, which is also very important, which means a new paradigm, renaissance, and a new way of thinking about what is possible and what can be done. I think it's a very, one can use exactly the same methodology if he wants to explore the evolution and what happened in endoscopic skull-based surgery. So, there was a need, there is a need certainly for a new way, a new product. People need to access areas in the skull base that are almost impossible or much harder to access by any other way than via the nose. And the key of do not cross nerves, as from the Pittsburgh group, it's a driving factor, I think, of this evolution, though there is a need to get there. Then there are the technical advances that we had earlier that would make this possible. And that's the better endoscopes, better visualization, the quality of the endoscopes and cameras, the CT and MRIs, the neural navigation, the powered instrumentation, all of this made it possible. But also, it's important to say there has been a change in culture, a new paradigm which is more collaborative medicine, the real implementation of the multidisciplinary way of working between ENT, neurosurgeon, ophthalmologists, made this possible. So a combination of these three factors, I think, was key in the developments, would drive the development of endoscopic skull-based surgery. And a good friend of mine, working from the Imperial and under the direction of Professor Ara Darzi, made this network analysis. He looked at the way innovation in surgery is progressing, is spreading. And he looked specifically at the use of robotics. And what he looked is the network analysis of citations and nodes and the way that people are exploring and adopting different technologies, different methods in surgery, in different surgical specialties for that matter. So it was very interesting. He found two different ways of transmitting innovation, of transmitting a new idea. And one was a model based on diffusion. Someone, a central center, is producing something, writes a paper, and people quote this paper. And they always refer to the basic one, that's diffusion-based, broadcast-based diffusion. One center is broadcast, and the other is the viral model. Well, different centers adopt the same, I don't know why it's not working. Different centers adopt the same method, and then they themselves become source of innovation. And they are quoted, they are cited in different articles, and in this way it progresses. And basically the method that a new innovation is spreading from the early stages will predict its eventual success. So if an innovation adopts from the beginning a viral adoption, has a viral adoption cascade, that is highly predictive of whether it will take, it will be something that will be implemented, or it will just wither and die out. And in our part, in endoscopic skull base, you heard earlier, once more, there are different issues. There's visualization, navigation, thanks. Thank you very much. Instrumentation, maybe it's the right, wrong, yes, it's not. Instrumentation and reconstruction, the robotic manipulation. And all of these factors are crucial to how we work, and all these factors is where technology plays a role. So visualization, I think, is by far the most important. In order to operate, the first thing is you must see what you're working on. And This is an example. This is one of the first pituitaries that I did back in AMC in Amsterdam with Wouter van Futhe, a neurosurgeon. And this is a view of the cella. That's 2007. That's 11 years ago, an SD camera at the time. So we're taking the bone out from the cella. You can see the image. You can see what you're working at. You can visualize the face of the cella, the eggshell bone. After opening up the dura, we're working in the cavity where the adenoma was. And you can see the posterior wall of the cavity, you can visualize it. You get a good feeling for what you're doing. It's certainly a big advancement over microscopic surgery, but it's not ideal. It's not ideal. At the time, we thought it was great, but of course, it depends on what you have tried and what are your criteria are. So step forward, we're doing more extended case with time. So that was a child who had a post-chiasmatic craniopharyngioma. And for this tumor that you can see sits above and below the pituitary gland, the way to go is drilling the clivus and then moving the pituitary gland to the side, again, as was described by the Pittsburgh group, and then working behind it. And we bought a 3D scope at the time. We were lucky to get a grant, an innovation grant from AMC, and we bought a 3D scope. Now, I don't have a 3D projector, but this is, you get two images, left and right side, which are like this. What we found is that we got very good contrast. We're very happy with the degree of contrast and colors. But again, we felt that the detail was missing. We could get a real 3D view, and that was certainly an advancement. But when it came to protecting some key areas and to really finding the limits of the tumor. Here you can see we're opening this, this is the dura in front of the cella. See in the next video, we open the cella, we move it to the side, and now we're working in the cavity of the craniopharyngioma. We're looking towards the third ventricle. And there you can see the third ventricle and the final part of the craniopharyngioma being dissected. This is very important. Something in neurosurgical terms to protect the hypothalamus, to avoid getting any disorders of appetite and weight. And the final view after the craniopharyngioma is removed. So we got a very contrasting image, but our feeling was with much less clarity. And with the 3D systems, another problem at the time was, so we ended up not using it. We bought the system, but we didn't use it a lot. And I think one of the factors was that we didn't get a lot of detail, plus, in any case where there was some soiling of the camera, there was some blood or anything entering the camera, the image would be unusable. So step forward, and of course that is the result after the excision. There was a complete removal, and the patient did very well. And I've been using a 4K camera in my hospital, again, since September, October of last year, so about 6 months. But unfortunately, we didn't have a 4K recorder, so I got one, and this is a video from last Thursday. This is an adenoma, and in my mind, there is no comparison. The degree of detail that you can get, you can look at the face of the cella, you can visualize very clearly the dura, and even the small vessels in front of the dura, that then you can cauterize at the time of incising the dura. You can see here, it's not a major issue, but it makes this little bit bloodless, the first part of the incision. And then here we're incising with a sickle knife, Capabianca sickle knife, the face of the cella. This was a non-secreting adenoma of the pituitary gland. And you can see the first material, although we had some issues from radiological issues, if it was a cranio-radke cyst or a non-secreting adenoma, because there was some proteinaceous material, but you can see in the next part of the video that it was clearly a non-secreting adenoma. And using the scissors to open up the face of the cell and raise the dura. And again, it's about visualization. You can see any remnants, and that's the key thing with using an endoscope, of the adenoma that can hide between the cavernous sinus and the diaphragma cella. And you can see little parts of the adenoma, and that's key to getting a complete removal that can hide on the right side between the cavernous and the posterior wall of the cella, and then on the top corner, top left corner, again, between the cavernous anthracnose cella. And the last part of the operation, we always use a 30-degree scope to look around. And you can see the diaphragmatic cella coming down, confirming that the excision is complete, but also a direct look into the cavity. And my feeling is that the colors are much more, they're not so impressive, but I think they're much more realistic than with other kind of visualization. And then with the 30 degree, finally, the last corners and completing, ensuring the complete removal of the tumor, and then putting some flocil to close the gap. So for me, this is certainly an advancement. It's very hard to argue that having more detail in what you do will not help you in operating. And I think that's something that's crucial for our work. And we have some more time. Reconstruction is a big issue. If you work in endoscopic scalp base, you learn very quickly that the limitation is not so much what you can remove, it's how you will close the holes that you create. It's not about doing the jump, but actually controlling your fall after the jump. So 3D printing is something that can be useful in that respect, and I was looking in the literature. I don't have personal experience, but there have been some attempts. Basically, you can use neural navigation during your surgery to map out the defect that you have created, and then in real time with a 3D printer and the appropriate material, you can create templates that will fit exactly in the defect that you have created in three dimensions. And that's something that has been explored, as you can see in this very recent study from a couple of months ago. And I think that's something that will be seen more in the future. And then finally, it's robotics, which is a big issue, and I think it's the next big thing that will come in endoscopic scalp base, but it's not there yet. And the reason it's not there is there are three key limitations. Number one is the large size of the robotic arms that we have, which are usually more than 1 centimeters. Number two is the lack of flexible single port systems. And number three, they are developed for soft tissue, not for bone. And that's why there are some cadaveric studies. There has been no significant clinical uptake. And the morbidity for access is really unacceptable. So, as I said, the latest Da Vinci SI single port system has 25 millimeters cannula, 2.5 centimeters. And that contains, of course, the endoscope plus the two instruments. So it looks like this. It could be used for, and it's very useful for transoral work or other work in the rest of the head and neck area, but certainly not possible to put a 2.3 centimeter port through the nose. So flexible robotic system, the flexibility is also important, and there is a flex system. But the third key is drilling. And if you want to do scalp-based surgery, you need to be prepared to remove some bone. And the problem is that all the instruments you can see that exist for the current robotic systems, they have graspers, they have bipolars, even laser, but there is no provision made for any drilling, and that will be an issue. So there is no existing robot that combines the three key features, and attempts to use the robots for scalp-based work have had an acceptable morbidity. For example, this model of accessing the scalp base through the tongue base means significant morbidity, like the seat tours, and including neurovascular injury, of course, and hemorrhage. Or another attempt has been made to use the Da Vinci robot, but again, via bilateral anterior maxillary antrostomies, which again, I think it defeats the purpose of doing endoscopic surgery with this kind of access. So, here comes a suggestion, an idea. We have been working with Technical University of Delft, and Paul Bradfield, he's an engineer at the Technical University of Delft, and he has shared with us some of his ideas. So all these instruments that we have been talking about, the robotic systems, are basically steerable instruments. So they have a very complex skeleton, and they have complex parts that guide wires. And they're very difficult by definition to miniaturize. You cannot get this kind of pulleys and ropes in very small dimensions. They're complex and they have a lot of parts. So his inspiration, in a way, was to look at the what's happening in nature and look at the different skeletons that exist and how can skeletons move in different directions, how are they structured. And he looked at the octopus, and what he found is that there are two sets of muscles, the transverse muscles, which are longer and thinner, and then you have the longitudinal muscle bundles, which are shorter and thicker, and together they create the movement. So the idea is to use not an instrument where you have complex different parts with pulleys, but have an integrated cable ring approach where you have a simple flexible skeleton. The skeleton itself is part of the guiding system. You don't have a separate structural skeleton and then a system to control it and guide it, but they're integrated. So in this way, he thought he could miniaturize and create smaller diameter instruments by using self-guiding cables and functions that are not integrated, can work in different ways, structural and guiding. And in this way, he created, the first thing he created was a very small 0.9 millimeters, so that's less than 1 millimeter instrument that would be steered in different directions, that can be very used in ophthalmology, some laparoscopic instruments, and then multi-steerable device, such as the multiflex, which is 5 millimeters, which is about the size we're looking at if you want to operate in the nose. And on the basis of, this is just an artist's impression of what he would like to do, basically is the instrument that can follow in multiple degrees of freedom, the movement, so not just in one direction, but in multiple directions, so it can go around the corners and work around the corners, and because it's purely mechanical, it's easier to miniaturize, and it doesn't have the complexity of different systems. Oh, let me continue the video. The challenge, however, in such instruments is the steering. So you have to organize the package. If you want to work with more than one arms, then you must miniaturize them and bring them together. And the other issue is following a path. So the idea is to create an instrument where you have, let's say, a move of the instrument being followed the same way like a snake will follow using the same path that he created, it created earlier. So using this prototype, he created an instrument that can go around the corners and can follow the same path without losing the original configuration. And of course, the challenge here is having multiple arms and how to use a user interface that will control them. So the idea is to have a safe memory control of the entire device and then a cluster safe memory control for different arms and then individual safe memory of individual arms. With the final, again, plan at some moments in the future, something that's under development, is to finally be able to create what would be an ideal robot for what we're talking for, which would have the integrated functions of the different arms, the endoscope, plus the two controlling arms, and it can go around corners, while at the same time staying in a miniature size that would make it possible for transnasal and skull-based work. And this is something that is in progress from his PhD students and his whole group in Technical University of Delft. And thank you very much.